I'm Dom from Nothing But Thieves, my glamorous assistant, Stuart, who looks after me in every capacity. And this is my live rig rundown. We're going to do guitars first, so let's go, let's just go what's closest. So this is a Gibson ES-335. I've been playing this for what?
About a year and a half now, I think we've been rolling with this.
About that, and we needed a humbucker guitar for design for the rhythm part, didn't we?
That's correct.
And we were kind of just looking for something that had a bit of chunk, but wasn't too bright. And this guitar just works amazingly with any kind of sort of gain stuff on the board. So I only use this at the moment for...
It's pretty much just two songs, using it for design and for Sorry.
Yeah. And again, for Sorry as well, we didn't want anything too bright.
The Telecaster's just a bit too thin compared out to the humbuckers, and it's just got a bit of a resonance about it.
The other thing was that there are three guitars in that song, and we're very cautious about treading on each other's toes, so we wanted to make sure that we were all sitting in a different sort of frequency range. So this is the SG that I play for a song called Number 13. I actually share it with Connor.
Yeah, you and Connor are both sharing it out.
This is probably the nicest guitar that we own. There's only 300 of this model made. And it's like the perfect SG, like it's well balanced. The tone switch is just ridiculous from pickup to pickup. And then, it's just an amazing guitar. You can't really describe it until
it's
you
just,
play it.
It just growls, like it's got such a mid-range growl to it.
Yeah, so this is an amazing guitar. I want to try and find more excuses to play it, but...
It's going to become a permanent one soon.
Yeah. This is probably the most unique guitar I have. So I had this made by my next door neighbour, a guy called Paul Fay, and he's never built a guitar before. And I kind of told him what I'd like, and he's built this from pretty much scratch. I got the body and I've got a neck from Fender, and he started modding it. I've got these Fishman pickups put in. They're the Fluence.
Greg Koch.
Yeah, Fluence. Pickups. And the guys from Fishman actually sent me a strap pickup for the middle as well. They actually only normally do bridge and neck. So the fact I've got the middle one makes it quite unique. They're active as well, which is a bit sort of over the top. You have to charge it, which is not...
It's like a phone charger.
It's not the most rock and roll thing, I'll be honest, but...
But it's got great battery life. You know, you can get like 300 hours out of it, so...
There you go. That's a few gigs.
It's pretty good for
and
that.
And then there's a few like custom bits on the back. I got the logo put on the back, which was quite cool, just on the neck plate. All my guitars have 11s on.
Yeah.
And I occasionally have heavier ones on the... on the ES-335. And then this is the guitar I probably play the most. It's just a sort of more basic version of that without the big Bigsby. This is a Fender Elite Tele. They brought this out a few years ago and I've been playing it ever since. I got the Fishman pickups put into that too. It's just a workhorse, isn't it?
Like it's a Frankenstein guitar. It's like, it's gone through the wars. We've had it, you know, it's been thrown around. Been chucked on the floor and it just
keeps going.
It just solidly performs.
It's great, like just little things like obviously play with strap blocks because the worst thing which has happened to every guitarist is just when it goes like that and you drop it. It's got the locking tuning heads which you're a fan of.
Just a huge, like the Fender ones just really work, like they never break, so it works out perfectly.
And yeah, the Fender have been so good to us over the years and I'll probably continue playing Telecasters for a while because they just suit my style of playing quite a lot. So. They're my main guitars, and the rest of the boys use those ones. And it seems like it's quite a lot, but this is a stripped back SG, he's letting us have it at the moment because it sends him mad. So amp setup is not actually that complex. Behind the amp, I've got a Vox AC30. It's a hand-wired one.
Yep.
And they've been really good to me. I've always played Vox amps, but I kind of was liking what the Marshalls were doing when we were plugging them into the cabs, and we actually had an amp shootout day, didn't we? We just stacked
26 amps.
We had a lot of stuff and we were just going through them to work out what was suiting us best. So yeah, it goes from the Vox into the Marshall, and then mics wise I've got a 414 and just an SM57. I love the 414 because it's just like spectrum wise it just picks up everything. And in terms of like just getting like that classic exciting guitar sound, the 57's the one. Something that is a bit unusual is on my board, I can switch out into an interface which goes into this Apple Mac here. And I'm running like a load of different sounds through through Mainstage. So we have a song called Like Animals, and I can't create the main sound with pedals. So I have to then go into to Mainstage just by switching it. Stu kind of manages that and makes sure that it's all working. But that's cool as well because it gives you a stereo image. So out front, our sound guy Gary gets a lot to play with, and it just sounds monstrous.
Just gets to be creative with what you're doing.
Yeah, so that's really cool. But that's the amp setup. It's not too complicated. So just to keep Stu happy during the gigs, if he's having a hard time with stress, we've got a photo of Phil with a hat on, which does keep us all quite happy. Now, coming out of this, I have one patch over here, and this is for Like Animals, and I can't really go into all of it, but there's a lot of stuff going on in terms of compression and amp sims and phasers.
It's like four pitch shifting.
Pitch shifting, all sorts of stuff. And then for number 13, there's a sound in the middle eight, which is a bit pretty crazy, which I use a plugin called Isotope Trash and just a reverb, but it's the right blend of it, and it gives you a bit of a weird sound. So yeah, that's how we run stuff out of the board into the Mac. And it's really important that the signal that I get from my board is clean. So it bypasses all my pedals, so it goes straight in.
Basically, from the ES-8, it goes on output 2 straight into main stage. So I'm essentially, all I'm getting is, you know, guitar.
Like a DI.
Yeah, like a DI of the guitar signal.
So it works. This is basically trying to model how I would record guitars, like for the demos, because this is exactly how I found these sounds, by just messing around with plugins. So it's important for us to get to as close to that sound as possible live, basically. So that's kind of how the whole thinking behind this setup is. The easiest way to explain the boards, which is amazing, by the way, so a guy called Dean from Bedford Audio had built this from scratch, and he is very, very sort of, well, he's OCD, and I love that about him because it's just the neatest thing I've ever seen. And when I got it out of the box, I was just shocked. So yeah, I've got this ES-8 switcher, which is changing a lot of my pedals for me. So I've started off with the clean sound. My amp is fairly, like, if I dig in, it will crunch up anyway. But if I play softly, and then if I dig in, and that's because these, so I've got this active switch on the guitar as well, so look, I'll take that off. And it just gives me more gain, and it's so reactive, so that's really cool. So yeah, clean sound there. Then I go into this Messner, I've got the Walrus Messner and the Walrus Descent. And this is a drive pedal, and this is like a reverb, but it's kind of got effects on it, reverses and halls and all that sort of thing. So the drive pedal. So it's kind of, it's not too bright, which is good. You've got to be careful with that with tellies, I think. And then it kind of, sometimes I will back that up with the EP booster. So the next one is this, it's one of my favorite companies, Way Huge. It's this Echo-Puss. And the reason I've got some tape over it is because you can modulate the delays, which they actually go out of tune afterwards, which is cool, but I play this as a straight delay, so I kind of want it to be more like, yeah, not too modulated. Reverb, like I say, this is the Descent, which is an amazing pedal. And you can hear the octaves on top and bottom with that. The other thing you can do with this pedal, which is really cool, is reversed stuff, so. Which is just amazing. The way it swells is just so aggressive. So that's fun, I like that. And then yeah, I combine a few pedals together, like so these are the reverbs and delays. If I'm doing swimmy stuff, that's always great for that. Like animals. Actually, it's quite important to say that these three pedals here are before the looper, so I basically can use the freeze at the end of songs. So when I'm changing guitars, I might just finish on a chord. And it will hold it forever, so I can change guitars with Stu and then just turn it off. The pitchfork is my favourite pedal on the board. It's just insane. I use this for Amsterdam, so it goes. Which is a really cool sound. It's kind of, I detune all my guitars when I record, so I love this pedal. And yeah, the EP Booster, just a must on any board, I think. It just fattens everything up. Which is really cool. And then, I guess, what we were talking about earlier was this switcher here, which splits off the signal. So, on Like Animals, when I get into the chorus, in the drop, I will click up on this bank, and then click this again, and then that will now be going into the MacBook through Mainstage.
So, you've got output one and two that come from here, which basically we can mute one or two or have both coming out. What that basically does is the ability to shoot out the signal where we want. So like Dom said, when we go to that patch there, you've got outputs one and two off, one and two on. When you go to the clean, you've only got output one. Output one then goes into the lay little dual, which basically splits it into output A and B. That gives us the two amp option if we need to have the two amp option.
I was debating a lot, wasn't I, about using two amps live, and I still am, but Stu doesn't like that.
It just creates more work, but
it works if one amp, it doesn't.
But they sound, yeah. I mean, simplicity is sometimes just the best. But the option to have it seems stupid not to build something on the board that we could have the option if we wanted to change over.
Yeah.
So yeah, being able to split his exact signal, and the fact we've got phase split in there just in case we get any phase issues. We've got ground lifts on the little dual. This thing basically saves my life, kind of for buzz ears, and because we've also got the output, we've got so many outputs going, we sometimes will get a bit of ground hum from the MacBook or we'll get it from the amp. A couple of switches through the lay just to check that, and it usually bounce gone.
Yeah, it was a bit of a nightmare to find clean signal, especially when we were abroad and having to use, what do they call it?
We had to use inverters.
Yeah, that's all been set up beautifully. And again, that was all Dean's decision when he was building it, and he smashed it.
Using a couple of Voodoo power supplies, but we're actually using two different Voodoo power supplies underneath. We're using a 4x4, and I can't quite remember what the...
I'll show you the back, actually.
Let's go under.
Not showing in the outputs as well, so if you come over here, you can see, fuck, this thing is heavy. So, yeah, you've got the two power cons in, amp A, amp B. This is it's labelled Ableton, and this is the input for the guitar. So, we're obviously not using the B output at the moment, but it's there. And a little plug for Bedford guitars there.
and then underneath,
you've got the...
this is where the beauty sits.
And this is Stu's favourite thing here.
Just the dip switches, especially when you're on like 220 power, just being able to flick through a couple of them just to try and find something that might not work with a certain pedal. There's like an echo drive on there, and the TS9 always caused me a little bit of issue, along with the delay, the Echo-Puss, but just to cut the dip switches on that, could flick them down and suddenly we were back in business. That's just a really well done
board. We've got Dean smashed it. He's made our lives so much easier.
I'm Joe from Nothing But Thieves, and this is my rig.
Start with the guitar.
Well, sadly, this isn't actually my one. This is a Gibson Goldtop from
57 now?
Yeah,
it's old.
So. It's old. I mean, it's definitely the best guitar that, well, I don't own, but it's the best guitar I've ever played. Our other guitar tech, Ryan's loaned it to me, hasn't he, for a while?
He has.
Just plays like an absolute dream. I'm a little bit worried about touring with it because I don't want to break it.
No, but it is it's such a good sounding guitar. It's up there with the SG.
I mean, I'm going to offer to buy it from him, but he won't say yes, will he?
It's true.
Let's be honest. Probably my main guitar, the Gretsch Panther. Had this how long now?
Oh,
2 years,
God,
2.5 years?
Maybe three. She's beginning of the last album.
Yeah, I think so. Got a couple of these. Love the Bigsby on it. Use it quite a lot. It's just a great sounding guitar. It's like, it does everything. It's for great for distortion tones, great for clean tones, atmospherics, really holds up to everything like that.
It's kind of Gretsch's answer to a 335, but
it is.
With a different kind of character to it.
Yeah. That's what I mean. I find it just adds character to everything I play. It just adds a little nuance, which I really, really enjoy. I'm going to try and get one of the solid bodies off Gretsch this year because they're announcing some, aren't they?
Now, the unannounced ones.
The unannounced ones. Fingers crossed. The Maton, the heaviest guitar I own.
Weight is a sign of reliability.
Weight is a sign of reliability and a bad back. From Australia, I can't really get them in the UK much, I found. But we went to the
Maton factory.
Little surprise, wasn't it, for me? You did
little
that.
Surprise, hooked you up with the Maton factory.
Yeah.
Little tour.
I make them all by hand. Amazing, amazing guitars, like sustained for days. Really solid. Gonna try and maybe get something signature done with Maton this year, aren't we?
Would be nice.
Possible. Go. Yeah, Maton.
Sort it out.
We're back in July in Australia, so hopefully
go visit up and just have a little chat to them. Yeah. Their acoustics were second to none.
Yeah.
Believe the quality of them.
Lost the tone knob on this, mainly because I keep having to pull it out I use this guitar for design mostly. And that's really useful. Turns into single chord guitar basically.
Just split and
A little split. Yeah, I really love this guitar. I really recommend them. I got turned on to him from Josh Homme uses them, Queens of Stone Age. So if he uses them, must be
right. It's got to be good.
Yeah. And my Strat, don't use this too much, but there are a few guitars, a few songs call for single coil guitars. It's a Strat, really. It's Fender were nice enough to give me this, weren't they?
Yeah, does what it says on the tin.
I mean, I keep scuffing up the guitars. And so do you keep scuffing up the guitars.
I don't know. Sounds like a Joe problem.
just a great Strat. And this is my Les Paul that is also on loan, actually, but from Gibson. It's a little bit less weighty, the new Gibsons. This one was 2017, I think.
Yeah, it's 2017.
They've hollowed out some of it. So it's still got loads of sustain, but doesn't break my back too much. It's really nice.
It's another solid
Gibson. Yeah,
straight out the factory. Didn't have to do much to it.
Can't really go wrong with them. Yep. I use this one when the gold top's going to go at some point. So
we'll go back to that.
Yeah. I've actually switched back to Marshall now. When I was first in the band, Nothing with Thieves, I started using the Marshalls. I was on JMP, like head and cab, and then I went round to. Did Fender Supersonics for a while.
Supersonics.
And then I did Vox AC30s. I still use them occasionally.
Yep.
But my new favourite part of the rig is the Marshall Bluesbreaker. The Bluesbreaker is just the best sounding amp I think I've ever played through. Just so much weight to it. Every like chord just like pushes through like the mix, which is all you want really.
It's actually their reissue as well, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
So it's like factory. Yeah. It sounds that good coming out of the factory.
Yeah. It's just a great sounding amp. Like, it really handles all the effects. I do a lot of effects. I do a lot of the soundscaping for the band, so it handles that really well. Also, just sounds great. If you literally just turn it on and put everything to 12, it sounds great. So you only need a minimal amount of tweaking, so you can always get a good tone out of it, whatever you want. So that we actually put that behind the cab. We're on in-ears. So put it behind the cab, face it away to the wall so I can really crank it and get the tone I want, get really like a lot of distortion out of it. This is why we've got the cab here. So when even within in-ears, it's still giving me air. It still feels like I'm playing. So this has been a big work in progress, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's gone through a lot of different versions. I'll start with this, the Gig Rig G2. It's the switching system I use. I was using so many pedals per show that this was like so necessary. It just came to a point where
we just tap dancing. Trying to put six pedals on at once. It just wasn't working out.
And it's not what you want when you're trying to give performance and you're trying to give, you know, play the songs the best you can. You don't want to be trying to put on six pedals at once. So yeah, this is a switching system. It just basically means it puts on. It could put on multiple pedals at once per patch. So. Say this is just the dirt tone. But then it goes straight to this and it'll put a phaser delay reverb on it. And then something like Hostage, just a bit more synthy sounding. Crazy, crazy delays and stuff on that. And then stuff like solo tone. So for my solo tone, I'm really into using a slapback delay, which I think sounds really cool. Makes it cut through the mix a little bit better as well. And I've got a little bit of an octave up on that as well, just a hint of it. Again, it's cut to the mix, just really like it. What else is on there? This actually isn't part of, it's this thing, it's a revolver from Hex. It's actually a German company. I think this guy makes them in his bedroom. They're really in demand. It took me like 2 months to get it. But probably the best, like most well-made pedal I own. It's a glitch pedal, so it does stuff like this. Which you may not think is that useful, but it is.
You've made it useful.
Yeah, I've made it useful, you've yeah. I mean, useful. I'm really into just stuff that sounds a little bit out of the ordinary. there's a moment in I'm Not Made by Design where that's like, you just like there's a break in the song and that just like pumps through the PA and it's amazing. You can also do stuff with it, like you can create a little loop of like, you know, 3 second loop of music, and then you can, it will like stay in the pedal and you can like speed it up and slow it down. So it's good for transitions in songs and that sort of thing. Whammy, just for stuff like solos, just to get a bit weird again. I did. For a long time have like 3 or 4 delays on the board. But the great thing about this G2 is that it has MIDI control. And with the Strymon, it means that no matter how many patches I have, this one pedal
will translate.
Can translate, yeah. I can have multiple different delay times per different patch. So the one pedal is doing this. It sounds like a trem, but it's actually a delay that the Strymon Timeline does as well. It's an amazing pedal, that, isn't it?
It's just, delays, reverbs, Strymon's always been like a bit of a go-to. Yeah. We had a Big Sky for quite a while, didn't we?
Yeah, that's on the B-board that we use. I just didn't have enough room to fit it on here, really. Two different types of gain. So this is just a clone copy.
The Archer, I want to say?
No, it wasn't the Archer in the end. We got the Mythos.
Mythos.
It's as good as a clone sound you're going to get for the Klon. The Klon is the ultimate drive pod, in my opinion. And it just sounds amazing. And then this is the Crunch, which is the Catlin bread. Yeah, I just use this for like a slightly less gainy distortion. Just good for stuff like that. I mean, it cleans up really well. Great pedal. For the solos, I'm using an EP booster, which Dom actually stole that idea, didn't he?
He did. You were the original.
again, it just adds a load of mids to the tone. There was a time when I was running that always on pedal.
We run it at like a lower setting, just using a preamp. I think because it was on that, like based on that JCM 800.
Yes, it was. Yeah, the Echoplex.
Yeah,
But there's no way to go when you do that. Like if you want to push through even more through for solos and stuff, it's got so many mids in it. This if it's always on, you've got nowhere to go. So that's just great for solos. Now adds a little bit of gain, adds a little bit of level. Just a couple of pitchforks. They track really well as far as, you know, like octave up and octave down. the ring mod, again, kind of just a bit of fun. Actually quite interesting to use it for solos every now and again, if you've got an expression pedal like that. I use it mostly for a song called If I Get Higher. Just with delays, it just goes crazy.
Got this small stone.
Small
back.
Stone.
1970s, yeah, constant thorn in our side.
Yeah, 70s small stone. In my opinion, the best phaser ever made.
True.
But yeah, the wiring in it is ridiculous, isn't it?
The wiring gets snapped inside because it's a free-floating PCB. Probably every 2-3 weeks.
Yeah.
We're flying, when we're sort of doing trailer tours, it's not so bad because it doesn't get bounced around. But that gets a solder iron taken to it. In fact, it got done today because it failed on the show last night.
Yeah.
But it is such a good sounding pedal.
It is, like amazing phaser. All that soundscape and stuff is just amazing. I think I got the idea from Tame Impala. Use that quite a lot. I won't be getting rid of that one ever, I don't think. Just classic Boss Tuner. And this was the replacement reverb I'm using, Digitech.
Yep.
Again, I was using the Strymon Blue Sky, which is amazing.
Yeah.
But no room on the board, literally run out of room. And I think that's it. That's the pedal board.
That is it.